Welcoming Mr. Nathan McClay to the stage.
So, how are you?
I'm good, Ad. Yourself?
Yeah, really good, mate. Really good. What's been happening?
Wow, it's been... I just got back from Europe. Was over there with Flume, and we did a run of shows. We did a couple of shows in London, played Roskilde Festival, went down to Corsica in France in the Med, which is pretty lovely. And... Nice. Yeah, lots of meetings and catching up with people over there. But it was good fun.
Yes, but it's also been pretty... It's like that had to sort of come at the end. It's like, but it has been good.
Yeah, I mean, it's what we've worked for forever. So it's great to have it humming along. And it feels like there's a really good vibe among all the artists, and it's quite productive, and there's collaborations. We had Chet Faker guesting in London at both Heaven shows, and George Maple singing on her track on the Flume record as well over there. So it's great when you're overseas and able to sort of tee up with other acts and do things.
And so when you said before that, like, this is what you've been working towards since forever, how long has it been?
It's been a long time. I think it's 9 years, our 10-year anniversary next year. So I mean, things started in a very different place to where we are now. Future Classic started just as a vinyl label for fun, a hobby on the side, while I was working at Inertia Distribution, doing all of their digital distribution business. And they were good enough to send me overseas and travel, and I was DJing at the same time, and hooked up with a couple of distributors over there that wanted to put out the records that we had in mind. Stick Figures being one of those, Adam's project. So at the start it was really just a hobby for us to put out 12s, and I guess now it's obviously much more involved. We're doing management, we're touring artists, and sort of got our hands involved in all the different bits of it.
So you were DJing, and then you went to work for Inertia, and then it happened from there?
I was always sort of DJing since school, I guess. And then I did some early internet radio stuff when it was still 56K internet radio time. We had like a guide to internet radio shows that were streaming. There was no downloads, but a lot of the community radio stations and Radio 1 and a few other stations that were popping up on the internet, like the Beta Lounge and Groove Tech back in the day, were doing broadcasts. So we set up a timetable to when those were happening, different shows. Did that for a bit, ran out of like money and were broke. And then Inertia asked if I'd like to set up their digital department, started online side of their business. iTunes was just launching. It had launched in the US, but hadn't launched in Australia. So
this is around 2005 or something?
It was earlier than that, I think.
Yeah.
It was a while ago.
Yeah, right.
But 2004 is when we put out. November 2004 was our first 12.
Oh, my God. Wow, it's that long ago.
It's a long time.
Right, okay. And what was the first 12?
It was Deep Child, What's Going Wrong.
Yeah.
Parrot Maker remix.
Yeah, cool. And Rick Deep Child was just out here recently.
Yeah, exactly.
Playing at Mad Racket.
Still doing his thing.
Yeah, living in Berlin.
Speaking fluent German.
Yeah. As impressive. You do. Yeah, if you're going to be techno, you may as well go to Berlin.
Yeah, natürlich.
And so to sort of look at it on a bit of a macro level, you started the label, you know, as a hobby, but in a time... when, you know, iTunes and all this digital stuff was just starting to happen. So 56K streaming, iTunes and NoShare weren't yet in digital distribution, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So there's a couple of questions that come in there. Like, one obviously is, you were a new business in an industry that was changing incredibly, you know, so it went from physical format things where you could actually charge people for stuff and not hand it over until it, you know, they paid for it, through the whole change of digital and that kind of stuff. But also you went from being a label, so, you know, just putting out records, to everything here, which we see on this side of the website here, which is... you don't do news, but you do management, records, touring, events, bookings, publishing, all that kind of stuff. So talk us a bit through
changes. Necessity, I think. I mean, from a like for an artist today to make a living, it's important that everyone has an open mind about how that's going to be. And for our artists, everyone's different, but a lot of artists are making the majority of their income through performing. Still, other artists are songwriters and write for other artists and other projects, and maybe more on the songwriting side with more of a publishing bent. Then there's other artists that don't like going out on the road or don't want to perform and just like to record. So everyone's quite different, and I suppose all of those areas interest me. So we've become involved with artists and enjoyed exploring all those different fields. And as a business and as an industry, I think that part of it's always been what's excited me. That's what led me into doing that early internet radio stuff, the work with Inertia. And today even, that's what I think makes me most excited, is seeing it evolve and change and develop. I mean, we got into it basically as loving music and trying to work out how to do it for a living. And I guess out of necessity, we sort of wanted to explore these different elements of it. And that's led us to where we are now.
Yeah, sure. So what's been the latest sort of big development or change in direction or anything like that for you?
It's hard to say sort of generally. I mean, I think more than ever, we look at each artist as a different project and as a different, with a different perspective. We've got an EP coming up from an artist that's building nicely that we're going to give away for free, even though we've not done that in the past. It's going to be a free 3-track EP. It'll also be available for sale on iTunes and through different services. We've spent more money than we ever have on a video clip for it. So it's not like we're just giving it away and we're not investing in it or not taking it seriously. We're definitely giving it a strong platform. There's great remixes around it. There's going to be a vinyl release of the 3 original tracks from the artist, but it's also going to be free. So that particular project, we feel like we need to get that artist out touring internationally. And this is the right approach for this particular project.
Sure.
But everything's different.
So yeah, with each artist. Well, there's been lots of theories and lots of people trying different things with the free format thing, and over, you know, different periods, people have gone, you know, well, you have to just give it out for free to get traction. Or other people, might say that, you know, if you give it away, then, you know, you're throwing it away or anything like that. Mm. What function do you think the giveaway aspect is, especially alongside a sale product?
Yeah, I mean, I love getting music any way I can. I mean, I buy a record if I see it in a shop and it looks great and I know I'm going to forget about it if I don't grab it then. So I tend to just discover music through all different mediums. I definitely spend a lot of time on SoundCloud and have blogs that I go to and buy music in iTunes, particularly old stuff. It's just too easy to like spend heaps of money in there. But yeah, I mean, I think free stuff is important. And I mean, I don't really see selling music as an end game. For anyone. So sure. Of course it's great if you can sell lots of records and that can be a part of your income that keeps you sustained as an artist, but I don't think it's relevant these days to think of it as being good or bad in a blanket sense.
Sure. Yeah. And on that point of the end game, like most people, especially when you're starting out producing and you think, well, I've got to get signed to a label, the whole equation in your head is make tune, find label, get signed, get it out there, you know, end game. But what is the end game?
I think the end game is making a living out of music and not doing shit jobs, basically. So, I mean, I did shit jobs before I did better jobs. Yeah. And, you know, that sucks. And if you want to be spending time doing what you love, as soon as you're doing that, I think you're winning and that's great. And then it's just building that and getting that and developing it. So
So that's anything that you can do to, you know, make a living through
it. It's a process. It's you're never like, oh, shit, I'm happy now, everything's fine. I mean, you're always going to be wanting to push yourself in whatever it is you're into. So as long as, yeah, if we can help our artists get to the point where they're, like, stoked and they're having a good time and they know they have to work their asses off still, but it's at a place where, you know, when I met Harley Flume, he was at Hard Rock Cafe and he was like, this sucks.
Yeah.
But he was like, this is kind of fine. But
yeah.
When he got to quit that, he was happy. And
yeah.
I think if anyone gets extra time to make music and go out on the road or do whatever they want to be doing, then that's awesome.
Yeah. And he's now pretty much permanently on the road.
Yeah, it's kind of tipped the other way. He's like, can I not be on the road?
He's visiting Hard Rock Cafe for nostalgia purposes.
Yeah, now. I don't know. He's actually, yeah, I mean, he's at the point now he's like, this is really hectic. When do I get to chill?
Yeah.
And ultimately, you know, we try and tell all of our artists, like, this is what's happening, give them as much information as possible, but it be their decision what they decide. So there's a tour coming up again in November in Europe. He's just got back from Europe. He's about to go to America, but it's a great opportunity. So looks like he's going to do it.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
But I think if we were telling an artist or if we told him, like, you have to do this, then it's not cool. But if we try and give them as much info as we can and then they think about it and realize that they're responsible for their own destiny and decisions and opportunities.
Yeah, right. So on that point of, like, you know, letting them make decisions, like, from what I understand, you're actually quite involved in helping out with a lot of the creative decisions. So you don't write the tracks, obviously, but what other stages of the production do you like to sort of be involved in the conversation in?
I mean, again, it depends. I mean, like, each artist will have different things that they find they need advice or they want our vibe on, and quite often that might just be giving lots of music to them, just as, like, here's heaps of stuff we've found that we're excited about, from folk to electronic to whatever. And certain artists really want us to feed them music as part of their kind of inspiration or whatever. Others want sort of feedback, I guess, yeah, more feedback on songs and structures and arrangements sometimes. Then I guess it depends on the purpose. Like, if we've got a track that a band is writing for radio and they want to get our take on it, I mean, we'll then maybe send that to people that specialize in that area, like a radio person or a press person on the radio side, and get their take. So really it's just about sort of trying to tune in to what the artist needs.
Sure.
Feedback on and try and provide them access to the person that's going to give them the best info, or if that's us just giving our take on it, that's fine as well.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, cool.
So we don't get into sessions and get too technical.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's actually the opposite. The assumption is usually the opposite, that the label is somebody who takes a finished package and, you know, might get it mastered and then is just involved in pushing and marketing, but you're quite involved in the product creation.
Yeah, I mean, we don't have any, like, we do have a label, but I guess we're becoming, like, we're managing artists, so we're just involved in that everyday process of doing everything we can for them. And the label is for our managed artists. It's a vehicle with which we can put things out however we like, and we have a good infrastructure to do so. That said, even though we have our own label, some of our managed artists will also look at other labels to put things out on if it's more appropriate or if it's going to help the project in a more fluid fashion.
Sure.
If, like, Dixon wants to put out something on Innervisions and he doesn't want to do a remix, if it's going to be out on a different label, then why not give it to him and put it out on his label? Sure. As an example.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's not just all going through the one label or anything like that.
Yeah, it's completely open and depends on the circumstance.
Yeah, cool. So how do you find your talent, or how do they find you?
Yeah, we have a pretty insatiable appetite for stuff. So I guess it's a good question. I think we tend to, like, know bits and pieces about what's happening out there, and then different artists will approach us, or managers, or you know, there'll be just a general chatter among the artist community that we have in our roster. I go to South by Southwest. I tour around and go to different festivals. So talk to different people at those places. I ran into Chrome Sparks, producer from Ann Arbor in the States, at South by Southwest, and I was like, really love what you're doing. It's awesome. And we got chatting, and now it looks like we're going to be putting out his next EP. And he's got a US manager and stuff. And it was just kind of came to fruition naturally, and they wanted to do it, and we were up for it. So yeah, it's generally quite natural and fluid. We do take demos. People send us music on our SoundCloud page. When we get music, it's always, we focus on things if it comes through a trusted source, or if it's clear that whoever's sending us something has done a bit of research. If it's like, hey, you know, Russian tech house 1.9, listen, it gets deleted. But if it's someone who we know, obviously introducing something to us that we should check out, that we do that. But it's difficult to kind of get to everything, and I'm sure we miss stuff.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, how much stuff would you say you're listening to or assessing on a weekly or monthly basis?
I'm not really looking for things. We're trying to sort of not take things on at the moment, especially we're trying to focus on what we've got and do what we can with it. And we're really wary of having too many things on and not being able to do the right job for them. So yeah, unless it's like absolutely we just can't not work with it, then we tend to try and keep focused on our current roster and what we've got in the pipeline already.
Sure. So offering all these services and being such a sort of complete, I guess, ecosystem, and even though you don't sort of keep everything in-house, like you don't always take the releases and put them through the same label and that sort of stuff, you've got management, releases, tours, events, bookings, publishing, all that kind of stuff. How many people are on the team?
It's small. Like there's five full-time, there's a couple of part-timers, there's my wife who's our art director. And yeah, it's a really hectic little office in Redfern, and we just run around. But then each artist has booking agents in like different territories. There's we have publishing support from Cobalt. We have an admin deal with them, and we have their team pitching things on the publishing side. We have sync agents pitching masters in different parts of the world, looking for placements. There's all these other kind of people doing bits and pieces, not blanket for everything, but on a case-by-case basis. And I mean, things like the tours, I mean, if you just jump into some of those bits and pieces, we haven't done one for a while.
Yeah, let's pass these up. I don't know if you've ever used a German keyboard before, but...
exciting.
There you go.
German keyboard, impressive.
This is the challenge.
So on the touring front, what is going on? I don't even know. So yeah, I mean, I guess Biceps coming back again soon. Lindstrom, Tiger and Woods, they were like over New Year's. We're doing more touring on things like we're doing things for Sydney Festival, for Vivid. We're curating the stage for Laneway Festival. So that tends to be a little bit more kind of focused activity on a few different partners. Yeah, the booking side is looking after the roster that we book, who are generally our managed artists that we're looking after. Not always. What's or not's booked by Al at Artist Voice, and there's no sort of defined rules on how we operate. I guess it's just very much about relationships and having different people bring different energy to a project and being able to assess who's going to be the best for a particular project.
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, the record label is probably the most active at the moment. We've got quite a few 12 inches coming up. We started licensing bits and pieces for some of our touring artists, like Classics, and yeah, kids like Touch Sensitive, who is a previous Ableton
law school teacher,
exactly,
who's
currently doing 25 dates in the States.
Yeah, right, and blowing up, no doubt.
He's just doing shows for not much money a show, but they're covering flights and a com. He's meeting everyone. He's got a killer next record that I think is going to be awesome.
Yeah,
we're looking for like a US soul singer to sing on.
Right.
So yeah, it's just building, I guess, slowly, but. I didn't answer your question at all.
No, that's all right. I'm just on a slightly unrelated topic. Just if anyone can see this picture there, Michael actually does have larger legs than that. It's just an unfortunate angle. sorry.
Michael plays live and has a Ableton session going. And
he does, live bass.
With live bass. And yeah. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's right.
It seems to be working.
Yeah.
Let's leave him there.
Let's leave him up on there. His time to shine. We remember him fondly. And so what takes up the majority of, like, you know, time and resources? Like, which is the most resource-hungry part of the business?
I'm kind of trying to, I guess, I've been like a workaholic forever, but I'm trying to sort of take a bit of a step back from day-to-day things. We've got an accounts person now. Bits and pieces like that. So I'm trying to sort of make myself available to the artists for the plans that we're building. We've got a full-time label manager who's ex-Universal guy who's super awesome.
Wow.
Who's really organized. Chad, one of my partners who's been with us since the start, is overseeing the touring and booking side of things and also pretty deeply involved in the management stuff. Yeah, I've got a kid called Tom who is like assisting us with all of the administration and so on and so forth. Sanair, who does booking and admin for the touring side. So I guess it's just about balance of not taking on too much and keeping the projects that we're excited about rather than just growing because maybe we can.
Sure.
The label is pretty time intensive. But yeah, it's hard to say as such because around laneway time, for example, we're just all hands on deck. We've got 8 artists touring that we're looking after. So at different times of the year, different things are.
So the resources
are the focus. Yeah, exactly.
Whatever's currently on fire. Yeah,
totally.
Yeah, right. Okay.
And obviously, when Flume's record came out, we were like, just trying to tell people to go away every day. Lots of stuff coming in that we're managing. The US side of things, I mean, sometimes there's email chains with like 40 people on them with different agents and
Ouch.
People. So all of, like, managing all of those different relationships, I guess, is probably the most time-consuming part of it.
Yeah. So
sounds tiring.
It sounds exhausting just listening to it, yeah. So the Flume thing, if we could call it a thing, that must have, like, taken up everybody's time at that time.
Yeah, I mean, it was really good for us because I just had a kid 2 years ago, so we were just about to have a kid, and Future Classic had always been doing okay, but it was great to have, like, a watershed record that really kind of connected at a broader level and was still something that we were totally into and didn't expect. Like, we expected it to be a good record, but we put that into every record in a sense, so... it gave us a good perspective on the wider industry, I think, and I think it provides us with a great platform for our other artists to tap into bits and pieces of the world that he's playing in and choose which areas are appropriate for different acts.
Yeah.
So, yeah, definitely was time consuming, but again, we had some great people around us to help us.
Yeah, you're right. And obviously, you know, like we say, it's now become a platform for other things. You've just the next release with the new artists, you're able to put more money into the best video that you've done, you know, to date and that kind of
stuff.
Yeah,
so. I mean, there's less pressure.
Yeah.
I mean, day to day putting out records only, I think it's a pretty difficult place to be a label on its own. I think most of the more interesting companies that we're working with wearing a couple of different hats and they're genuine about what they are into musically and they're clever and just making the right connections with what needs to be done to build their roster and sensibly make decisions.
Yeah, sure. So just ask a couple of questions that sort of, you know, might be a bit more important for these guys and then we'll throw it out to questions from everyone. So given that you've been running for over 10 years and that you... you know, you have quite a hands-on connection with all the artists and each artist is unique, so it's very tailored, and that you run all these services. So, you know, full gamut of services, you're probably best positioned to speak in terms of what it is that makes a good artist, so somebody you'd want to work with.
I think a really strong artistic vision is the bottom line, and it probably always has been, before downloads, before recordings, even like I think the way an artist has survived has changed over the years and decades and going back forever. And I think artists with a very strong sense of what they want to do and a strong artistic voice have always prospered in some sense over time. And that's what excites us. I think that when you have strong pieces of art across any discipline, they rise to the surface and you can't kind of question them or doubt them. And that's exciting. And seeing them and having them being different is what's exciting me. I don't really DJ as much as I used to. And I guess I'm more excited now about finding things that are different rather than just things that are sort of representations of what I want to play on a Saturday night. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, there's lots of great labels that are just that for a label head who's a DJ also. But for us now, we're just really excited. I'm really excited about seeing artists that have a strong vision in what they're doing. Obviously, we have to totally be into it, but the variation there is quite interesting and exciting.
Sure. Now you've pulled up the SoundCloud page. What have you got to show?
I was just checking out to see how many plays we'd had on the Waveworks upload.
And how are we looking?
It's looking
holy
solid.
Shit.
It's like 30,000 in less than a day.
80,000.
We uploaded it this time yesterday. So
This is Wave Racer.
Yeah.
Can we have a listen?
Yeah, go for it.
So tell us about these guys.
It's one guy, Tom.
Right.
And he's 20. And he, yeah, these are his first two tracks, this and another track, so.
Where's he from?
He's from Sydney.
All right, he's local. Nice.
Yeah, I mean, nearly all of the artists at the moment are Australian, so.
Represent.
It's funny, because the locals, it's more fun to interact face-to-face or domestically, I think. It's pretty intense. A Kashmir Cat fan, as am I. Yeah.
So, how did you guys find each other?
He came. We did a FBI party with the Astral dudes, and I think Hugs or one of the dudes. Played me something. I was actually on YouTube and I saw it at the same time before I knew who was connected to or whatever. And a friend of mine in LA pinged me and was like, "Have you heard this?" And I was like, "Yeah, it's crazy. I was just looking at that last night." And then pretty soon, kind of the dots were connected and we're talking.
And it's been up one day and 30,000 views.
Yeah, I mean, he uploaded on his page as well. A couple of weeks ago, and it went up on Unearthed, and last week it was the most played song of the day, so pretty nice.
Nice. Wow.
So yeah, I mean, just super fresh. Like, this is just an example of something that we just like, and there's no master plan, there's no big backstory or anything. It's just a cool tune, and the guy seems really into what he's doing. And yeah, we asked him to do a remix before we started talking about releasing this, and then he was into putting it out with us. So.
Nice. And is this the one that you've done the video for?
No. This is something different. The video track is not up on SoundCloud yet.
Okay.
So the plan with that one is we're trying to get a US TV. It's a band. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't say who, but you could maybe guess. And the plan for that is to try and get like a US TV person, like a plugger on the TV side, to try and get a TV placement, and then roll out the free EP and remixes and video on the back of that, because we want to get this band to be touring in the States and doing more over there. So
right.
Wait and see. Very we'll see exciting. If it works.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I think I do know who you're talking about. So
maybe.
Yeah, and I reckon, yeah, I reckon they'll crack it. Cool. So any advice for these guys out there?
It'd be good to get some questions that are a bit more specific than just random advice. I mean, yeah.
Let's do that.
Like, it's great that I think Ableton Live School is awesome, and I think Sydney and Australia is like on fire. The whole world, like, there's totally opportunities now that I don't think we had 10 years ago.
No,
and it feels like you can really kind of make things happen pretty quickly and can develop hugely. I mean, very fast. So
totally good. Yeah, I mean, we started Live School because there was no other place that you could learn stuff like this, you know, back then. So,
and I want to hear what the kids are making at Live School, and I'm bored of the stuff in my playlist in 5 minutes. So it's great to have platforms like this that are encouraging people to experiment. And I mean, I think ultimately Future Classics heritage is a sort of experimental underground kind of thing. It's a lot of the music is not experimental underground now, but I guess that's what excites us, is not knowing what we're going to be putting out in 6 months.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, cool. Nice one. So we're going to throw around the mic, and I'll give you this one. Who's got some questions? Yo.
Hi. Do you sort of push your artists to put out more music while they're on the road touring?
It's always decision? It's kind of cool to put out stuff ahead of tours. I think, like, if you're gonna go on the road, like, I think when you're playing, if more people know your music, it's a good vibe when you're performing. So I think that's, yeah, the more music that people know of yours when you're playing a live set or even DJing, I think as an artist it feels better and you get a better response. So yeah, I think it's good to give away a lot of stuff, and I think SoundCloud's awesome, and you should upload all your stuff on SoundCloud until someone tells you to stop doing so, because they're going to give you money to stop doing so, kind of thing. It's like, SoundCloud's unstoppable, and I think that's one of the most I think it's much better than MySpace or any of those things that have come about. The guy who set up SoundCloud is an artist. He was releasing music and he still is, as Forsh on Sonar Collective years ago, and released an album last year. So it's like experimental hip hop stuff. It's really awesome. And now he's got like 300 people working for him. But it was always a very artist driven platform, and he had this idea in his head. We were one of the early beta testers of it when it's set up, and they were, he built SoundCloud as a vision of something that was very artist driven. It wasn't advertising centric. It was about tools and pro accounts being the way they make money rather than advertising and selling the business. And they never had, well, I don't know if that's true now, but for a long time, as far as I know, they never had sort of venture capital or money coming in from outside looking to get out of it. So I think they'll be around for a long time. And I think that as an artist, if I was making music, I'd be putting things up on my SoundCloud page as soon as I felt that it was ready. I think it's, yeah, important not to just chuck up things that aren't maybe finished. I mean, you can, it's fine too, but sometimes quality control is probably quite important when putting things online.
Thanks for that. Just on the SoundCloud thing, being a record label, would you prefer it not released on SoundCloud before it's sent to you?
No, I mean, this was up on SoundCloud, this Wave Racer track, and seeing its response on SoundCloud sort of validated my vibe on it. And so I don't think that's a problem if it's up on SoundCloud. Obviously, if you're working together and you're writing your third album and someone uploads it without telling us, then it's a bit of a problem. But
Jai Paul.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, that's interesting.
And when the Wave Racer was up on SoundCloud before being signed, was it up for download?
It was.
Yeah, right. Okay. And so that's no penalty.
It was up for download, I think, with a Facebook like, or maybe it was just a free download.
Yeah, cool.
So yeah, no foul, no penalty. That's good to know. More questions.
Hi. When you are choosing a track that you really think you like, and have you got like a sector in mind of what you? I mean, for instance, have you got an age range for your public or?
No, I mean we just have to really like it ourselves, and then there's nothing really. We don't think about who it's gonna work with or what have you. It's not sort of worked out that specifically. Is that what you mean? Is that?
Yeah, well, like you said that you are trying your this new video. You want to promote some artists to do some touring in the USA. So there's a strategy in there. So maybe I was wondering if there's a strategy also in what kind of music are you choosing, because you think that there's a range of age that you have your public is in you. You don't release music for people after 40 or just for 18 or, you know?
I mean, I think it's just what we're into. I mean, our office is filled with people, like our staff. Like, I'm the oldest. I'm the old guy. So, 20-year-olds in the office. I'm, like, 35. So, like, if I like it and they like it. Sometimes I like stuff that they're, like, it's weird. Like, I think a lot of the kids that are younger are getting into things that might have been around before they were out in clubs, and now they're discovering it and really seeing it in a fresh sense. So I feel like it's an exciting time, but age isn't really a factor.
Mm-hmm. And another question. Basically, you're running a label, you're paying some of people working for you. So where's in approximate percentage, where's the income coming from? Just events, festivals, bookings, because you're doing bookings, you're doing management. So could you give us a picture of what's the percentage?
For the artists, it's probably like it's majority live, like performing. And records are kind of, you know, some artists we hope to break even on putting out their records so that they can go on the road and play. It depends on the different stage that they're at, whether they're just starting out or whether they're sort of a bit more established. If an artist's on a second or third album, they're in a completely different space to if they're releasing their first song. So definitely initially we're not so worried about the recordings and trying to make money on them. It's more about an overall sense of creating a career for the act and a profile, so that they might end up doing, you know, some scoring for a film or a support touring for a bigger artist. But really, it's just about trying to find cut through for them as an artist.
Okay, thanks.
No worries.
Yeah, one more. All right.
So a lot of your artists and a lot of artists around Australia can probably trace the moment where they started doing really, really well to getting huge amount of plays on Triple J. Do you guys have like a special relationship with them or something?
I was asked to talk at a Triple J conference yesterday, actually, and I don't know whether it was just because I got some new glasses, but no one knew who the hell I was. So I don't think we have got like a special relationship. Our approach is quite like it changes record to record. Some like touch sensitive pizza guy. I think I emailed it to Louis, who's a friend and comes to our club shows, and then Richard Kingsmore emailed me saying, "Hey, what about me? Can I have this?" And then it got added. We didn't expect a sort of instrumental disco track to be added to rotation. It's great to see Triple J sort of like expanding their horizons, I think, and getting away from just being rock or whatever it was, and playing lots of stuff like Wave Racer and what have you. There's definitely things that we give them that they don't take or look at. I think it's becoming a more egalitarian media landscape. That sounds really complicated, but like with SoundCloud and things like that, having some tracks will do really well online and not really connect or do anything at radio. So there's more options, I think, for an artist, and it validates the release to see people enjoying it, whatever sort of area that's in. But Triple J is hugely important here, and if an artist does get support of Triple J, it Yeah, it definitely helps. I mean, FBI, RRR, PBS, RTR, all the communities are also a great and important platform that should definitely not be undervalued, because a lot of it starts there, and there's a lot of artists who haven't had any play on Triple J but have had great support from those community stations that are making a living and doing really well.
Okay, and then just one more question. So if you were to think of, they were talking earlier about the Sydney sound. If you think about the Melbourne sound, it's Melbourne Bounce. But then if you think about everything that comes out of Sydney, it's anything not house independent. Do you feel that's where Sydney's moving?
No. I hate all those sort of stereotypical sound stuff. Like, I'm really not... I don't really care if it comes from Ballarat or whatever. Like, I think people live online more than they live out in the community these days. So it's great to see... it's great to see scenes develop, but yeah, I'm not really... I definitely, for Future Classic, we don't really have any desire or to sort of support one particular sound or direction. And I hope it doesn't become that straightforward. I hope Sydney and Melbourne and Brisbane and all these places make all sorts of different stuff.
Cool. All right. I think we've taken up had plenty of your time. I know you're a very busy man. So, mate, thank you so much for coming down and sharing that.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Absolute pleasure. Give it up.